So as we launch into this, let me just set it up. We'll do a quick intro of everybody on the stage. We'll then have 45 minutes of discussion amongst the panelists, and the discussion will touch on really four aspects of education in the sciences: teaching, careers in the sciences, gender, and emerging markets. And we'll then move into Q&A, where I will enforce a strict rule: no political polemics, let's make it real questions. So with that in mind, let me just quickly go around. We'll start with Carl. Again, with the Nobel laureates here, they have been introduced to you before, so I'll keep it very brief. Carl won the Nobel Prize in 2001 for physics for achieving the Bose-Einstein condensation. I don't pretend to know what that is, I'm a historian, so. But it sounds impressive. But what I do know is that Carl, what I do know is that Carl is very passionate about education in the sciences, as we saw from his talk earlier this week. And so we are really looking forward to his comments. Then we have Danny Shenkman, again from Israel, won the Nobel Prize in chemistry for quasicrystals. My wife actually just asked him about those, and his reply was, "Do you mean rubies and diamonds? Because I don't know about those." But again, Danny is immensely passionate about teaching in the sciences, and in fact, he has anchored a TV show called, you know, what was it? Be a Scientist with Professor Dan in Israel, and he was kind enough to show me an episode of the show, and it's for children, and it's fascinating, and we're going to talk more about that later. We then have Brian Schmidt. Brian, again, won the Nobel Prize in physics, and part of his prize, part of the discovery, was something called dark energy, which as a little boy I thought existed, but it just frightened me, and I never know what it was, but apparently Brian knows what it is. But again, Brian is obviously passionate about education in the sciences. He's the Vice Chancellor of the Australian National University, which in that part of the world is the top university, but it isn't that hard because there's nobody there, last I checked. And then we have Tomas Vaimi, who has really the courage to be up here with the laureates. He's from Hungary. He is a student researcher at CERN, which sounds very impressive. And he's interested in particle physics and modern quantum theories, because the old quantum theories are no good. And I agree with you. They're rubbish. So with that, just a very brief background on what we'll talk about, and then we'll go into the Q&A, and I'll keep it very brief. The future of the world in a knowledge economy is all about innovation, and innovation is going to come from the sciences. And so it's no surprise that countries are investing heavily in innovation and the sciences, from the U.S. to Ghana. A lot of this investment is coming from emerging markets. An interesting statistic: in 2002, China had just 1.3 million students in its higher education system studying sciences. In 2013, that number had grown to 16.5 million. That's a 16, it's a 16.5, sorry, 6.2 million at a 16.5% compound annual growth rate. So these investments are tremendous, and we need to ask the question of, are they being made appropriately? Is it enough? And what are we doing for the betterment of humanity? Even so, there are some stark disparities. Africa contributes to just over 1% of total scientific output and has just 79 researchers per million citizens. In the United States, that number is 45,000 per million. Now, those researchers obviously have not influenced the United States to impact the Republican presidential nomination, so I don't know about the quality of the science there. But and other emerging markets are on the way up, with China at about 1,000 researchers per million. We also have disparities on the gender front, where even though almost 60% of all tertiary enrollments in the world are now female, which is amazing, because the workforce of the future will skew towards women, and that is the first time in history that that's going to happen, and that is a great thing. However, we have far fewer in the sciences. Only 43% of PhD students are women, and only 28% of researchers around the world are women. So what do we do to lift that and to change that? And lastly, how do we think about encouraging science at an early age, something that, you know, Danny is definitely involved in, And this is important because, you know, a school that I'm involved in the United States has a whole program around something called the learning disposition. The idea being that many students, male and female, young and old, sometimes think a subject is hard and then they shy away from it. Or they perform poorly in it, not because they don't have the aptitude, but because they think they don't have the aptitude. And you know, I think bringing science in early may help to address that. And of course, the last component that we'll talk about is technology and advances in MOOCs and other technology-driven learning devices and how that helps. So that's just a little bit of background. And with that, I'm going to sort of dive into the first of the four themes that we'll talk about today, which is teaching in the sciences. And with that, I want to start with earlier, so I'm going to start with Danny, and I'd love you to talk about some of the things that you're doing to encourage science for very young students, some of the model kindergartens, and I'd love you to talk about, you know, why you feel that matters so much.
Okay, thank you. Well, it all boils down to the following. The most important natural resource of every country and the most sustainable one is human ingenuity. And we have to foster it, and we have to develop it as early as possible. And so I think that every society needs more engineers and scientists and MDs and biologists and computer experts. These are people that open startups and develop economies. Problem is that in the modern world, young people don't wish to become one of these. They want to be managers and lawyers and accountants, which is wonderful, but not too many of them. And so, in order to foster the notion that a young person would want to become engineer, scientist, and so on, my idea was to start teaching science as early as possible. I'm talking about real science, no hocus pocus with liquid nitrogen and acid changing colors, nothing of the sort. Real science to kindergarten children. I started it in my hometown in Haifa with the mayor of Haifa. He turned to me after he heard me talking on the radio and asked me if I would do it in Haifa. I asked him, "Do you pay?" He said, "I will pay for the project," and this is where we started. We had a pilot of 60 kindergartens, 60 kindergartens, representing all walks of society, and we had a group of scientists teaching the kindergarten teacher science, and they would teach it to the children. Part of it was lost in translation. That is because the kindergarten teacher just didn't have it. They could barely understand, but when they had to talk to the children, it didn't work very well, and only half of them are left now, say 30 of them. However, the project has developed into creating science kindergartens, kindergartens dedicated to science in Haifa. This is something that anybody interested in early education should see, because it's a magnificent. These are magnificent places with laboratory for young children, amazing things. So this is project number one. Project number two, when I saw that the teachers, not all teachers, can really convey the message of science, I said, I myself would like to reach a larger audience, and I turned to our national educational television channel and proposed to them to create a program for me. The program is called To Be a Scientist with Professor Dan. In Hebrew, it rhymes. Lihiyot Mad'an in Professor Dan. Mm-hmm. And this is a wonderful program that you can watch on the internet, but it's in Hebrew. And also the title is in Hebrew, so it's not too easy to reach. However, anybody who wants the addresses on the internet can send me an email and I will send you a list of clips. Every clip is 15 minutes. The channel created for me a laboratory on the set with a laboratory assistant who is a young actress. Three children, age 6, come to the stage and we discuss science. The children represent all walks of society. The only requirement besides representation of society is that there will be talkative little children. They would like to talk because we need to discuss things. We don't want anybody shy there. And we discuss different subjects in science. Real science. How do you measure things? What is matter? How is matter built? Light and interaction of light with matter. Forces in nature, including fields, gravitational fields, magnetic fields. It's not so easy to explain. And we have only a few minutes to do that. So it goes on and on and on. These are the two projects that I'm involved in. And the last thing I want to mention is about the importance of teachers. In my opinion, teachers are the most important people in the world, in every country, because they hold the future of countries in their hands. And this is why we should do the following. Every country, pay them well and select them well. Some countries do a very good job. Some countries do a very good job. Other countries do not do a very good job. And this is the future. These are the people that create the future. We must pay great attention to what kind of teacher we want and select them and create a condition in which many people would like to become teachers. That means basically good salary. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Dan. And the comments on teachers are spot on. A lot of the work that we've done shows that countries that value teachers are countries that have the best teaching. Carl, I'm going to sort of work my way up the age group. So Carl, you already shared some comments on teaching in the sciences. Right. I think you only had 5 minutes yesterday, but you can take longer today, so you can go for it.
Let me just start by amplifying on a couple of things that Denny said about the research says. I mostly work at the university level and do research there, but for other things, I'm involved in research across the board. And one of the, there's kind of two critical aspects to this, is the research in the last few years has actually revealed that young children are capable of learning much more science than people had historically thought, and that you just have to make sure that it's presented to them in the right way and you don't get them confused with the language. But the actual learning capabilities of very young ages of scientific reasoning is so there's much opportunity there that people are really just discovering from the developmental psychology. And then the second area, though, has to do with teachers. That some, within these things vary a great deal around the world in different countries, as stated. But within the U.S. and many other countries, we know that the elementary education, the teachers of elementary school, is where the people, the part of the student demographics that have who are the most uncomfortable with science and sort of frightened of science and mathematics, that's the field they go into. And so this is a profound problem if you want those teachers to inspire and enlighten young children. And so when thinking about all these problems of early age, you really have to think about how you're training and educating the teachers, which takes me up to the university level of what do we need to do to help both those teachers and all the other students. And this is an area where there's really been great strides in the last few decades in understanding how people learn, particularly how they learn complex thinking, like thinking scientifically, and the most effective ways to actually educate them. And we have particularly good data at the university level showing there are certain methods that are just not just a little better, but they're 2 or 3 times better in their effectiveness. And, you know, if you stop to stand back and compared to what's the usual way that most university science courses are taught these days? And if you sort of stop to think about it, if you could sort of double the effectiveness of every class that a student takes, what that would actually mean in terms of the quality of the graduates that our universities could be producing. And so I think, you know, we really have the research now to allow enormous improvements there, and there are enormous opportunities that universities like ANU or a few are starting to take advantage of. But I think there's some hope for really major transformation, not just how universities teach, but also how universities are recognized by society as providing real special educational value. But they have to take a scientific approach to this of saying, okay, we're really going to not just work at cutting edge research in our science, but cutting edge research in how to best teach our students how to think scientifically.
And that's a beautiful segue for to Brian's world of, you know, leading a university, a research university. You know, how do you think about, is there a tension between quality research and quality teaching? Do they come together? And what are the things happening at ANU that you would say are new in the teaching of science?
Right. So there is a perception among some people that somehow teaching well and research are incongruous. It is certainly true that you do need to spend time to teach well. And so the great universities of the world will provide staff the time and the resources so they can do it and make sure they're teaching one class well rather than four classes poorly, which is, quite frankly, an approach that a lot take. And so, you know, from my perspective, it's coming to a deal and saying, what is a modern university? It's research and teaching right now. I mean, that starts back to really the Berlin universities in the late 1800s. And getting the psyche that this is what we're going to do, because ultimately the connections with the students actually benefit the staff. It's one of the most enjoyable parts for me. It makes my research interesting, and I have taught every year. This will be my first year I have not taught since becoming vice chancellor, but in all my time at ANU I have taught, and it hasn't slowed my research down. Indeed, it connects me with young people and the ideas and things around them. So as a university, you need to think, how are you going to motivate your staff, which is not used to really taking teaching seriously. You just sort of go through and using the lecture that was, you know, been around for almost 1,000 years, you keep doing the same thing, and you have to motivate it. And you have to, first thing, realize it's important, and realize it's actually not that hard. If you look at what Carl has done, you realize you can get huge gains with actually quite small changes. And it's just convincing your staff to do it. And you convince university staff by incentivizing it. If you tell a professoriate, do this, they will almost guaranteed turn around and say no. Sort of like a French worker, you know? You have to lead them. And so, sorry to my friends out there. So you have to go through and incentivize it. And part of that is you know, giving carrots. So for example, if you want to be promoted, you have to show a teaching portfolio. That's not the way we used to do it. It used to be just show me your Nature papers. Well, I'm sorry, these days you got to do your teaching portfolio and show that you're taking this seriously and looking at the research and measuring the gain and actually seeing how you're doing and reflecting on that and changing and getting that as part of the university culture. So we have essentially a group of teachers and researchers within my university who have gone through and created this sort of fellowship where you have different levels, and to achieve it, you have to not just develop your own techniques, you then have to go and help other people in the university, and you can use that as your demonstration that, yes, I should be promoted. It's very effective. It's self-supportive. It means it's quite easy because I've got the world experts to help you to make your teaching better. And then it's also a matter of looking what's going on in the rest of the world. So our physics department, we've been playing around with MOOCs, so we started an edX, and we could see from the data just how people iterate with that there are some things we can do. And we can test those in the classroom. We have done that. We took a reasonable lecturer, and that person changed the way they taught, and we measured the gain, we measured the student satisfaction. Guess what? Both skyrocketed through quite, you know, reasonable changes. So we've decided, geez, we need to do this, and we have completely in the process of revamping our entire physics undergraduate curriculum to be pivoted around these new ideas. It's a lot of work, but the entire faculty got together and got quite excited about it, because then it becomes a group activity that self-reinforces. And so you have to ultimately change the culture and make it as what you do, and you start in, I mean, I wouldn't have guessed that physics would have been the area that would have started this at the ANU, but it is. And it's partially because of, you know, Carl and other people's work, which we have gone through and done the data and just show it works better. So, as I said, it's that cultural change. And then it's a matter as a university of saying, look what we're doing. We're different than anywhere else. You want to come here. And that actually raises the prestige of your university probably more effectively than any single other thing than you can do. And so it's good on all fronts.
Before I move to Tomas, you tantalized us by saying there were two or three small things. You know, could you share?
I'm going to tell Carl to do that. He's the one who invented them. So.
But I guess another question for you though is you mentioned carrots. I didn't realize there were any vegetarians in Australia. I didn't know that would work.
lots of kangaroos, if nothing else.
So Carl, yeah.
I just wanted to follow up on a point made earlier about the connection between research expertise and teaching. One of the things are the kind of research that I look at that we find that teaching is much more effective is really having students practice thinking like an expert and getting good guidance from the instructor on doing that. But one particular feature of this is if you compare doing that compared to, you know, being the traditional talking textbook, we find that this kind of more effective teaching is much more demanding of your mastery of the subject. And so for the first time, really, we have a sort of real honest basis for the research university, for the fact that the best researchers who know the subject most deeply and understand knowledge in the subject and thinking in the subject are actually also teaching the subject. Now, but it's important to remember that's a necessary but not sufficient condition. We see that they really have to have deep content expertise, but then they have to have some basic expertise in the teaching as well. But they ultimately, they really do go hand in hand.
Now, Tomas, as a student, you are a victim of the theories of all these men. What do you think? And what you know, if you had to think back to your days as an undergraduate, as a master's student, you know, what would you wish were one or two things that had been done differently or better?
Okay, so I really like the lecture of Professor Wyman because that's what I think the best. So, but I feel that if I work on the subject myself, that's much more effective than to going to classes. And so I must admit that I'm not going to much classes in the university. So now I can tell the professors that this was also a result of research. So that's the reason why I'm not going to the lectures. But anyways, I feel this very effective to do things by myself.
And you know, one area that you have been very involved in is in MOOCs and in using technology in teaching. And it would be great now to start with you, and then it'd be good to get the reactions of the laureates to that. So
okay, so let me answer this question in context. As you mentioned, I primarily work at CERN, but secondary I work at the Hungarian Institute, a talent center, which is called the Milestone Institute, and that's for secondary school students. So we have the kindergarten, the university, and I'm teaching at the secondary school kind of thing. And this institute is built on three things. The first one is societies, which is not that relevant in this panel, but the second one is module system, and the third one is mentoring. So in this module system, what we do is that we give the material to the students before the class, and they come to the class with questions. So we can discuss and we can give feedback to them. And the mentor system, it means that every student has an individual mentor, so we can have a very, very good feedback to them. So if they have any question, we can go to them and then deeply discuss that small part of the topic. So answering the question is that MOOCs are very, very good for these, both for the module system and both for the mentoring. But what I believe is after the MOOC, you need some feedback. And for this, this is the, why we have this mentoring system, that you can go to your mentor, and after you listen to the MOOC, you can ask questions and then go into the deeper part of that.
Great, great. I'm going to, just for the interest of time, move a little bit into the question of careers. Oh, sorry. I wanted the laureates to comment on MOOCs because it is such a hot subject. And again, leading a university that has stepped into the world of MOOCs quite aggressively, it would be great to get Brian's view and then just move down the list.
All right. Well, you know, we joined edX about 4 years ago, and part of our agreement would be I would prepare 36 MOOCs with a colleague, Paul Francis, who is an educational expert. And the first thing is they're a lot harder to do than you might think. They take about 60 hours per hour of MOOC if you're going to do them well.
Wow.
You need to design lots of interactive bits. You realize very soon that the average attention span of a person is universally 6 minutes. With kind of a half-life, and so you design everything around these 6 minutes. You have questions, then you need to come up with assessment exercises that can be scaled up but are quite interactive, and so we do our sorts of interesting problem solving, which is, you know, mass 10,000 people trying to solve them. But the process of this has taught us a lot. This is the basis that we have now changed our entire physics curriculum. And, you know, the vice chancellor of the day said, this is a disruptive technology. I don't want to be investing in something that's going to eat our lunch. And I said, oh, that's exactly why you want to invest in this, because it's going to eat our lunch. So I think the MOOCs serve a purpose. And, you know, my purpose of a MOOC is everyone gets something better, but you tier it into the level that you use it. You learn from it. And, you know, you can provide, you know, if you're in the middle of nowhere, you can get my 36 lectures on cosmology and whatever else. Some people here have taken, because I've signed certificates since I've been here. You also get the ability to use that technology in your own lectures locally, and then you augment it with, you know, personal tuition at the university. So I think it's an interesting evolving space. It is going to be important. I don't quite know how in the future.
Danny?
Well, you know that in most universities we have feedback from the students, how well teachers, professors are doing. And we have it in my university at the Technion for very many years. I have been the best one for consecutive 10 years, so I'm out of the competition. They don't want in the competition anymore. But that besides the point. The thing is the following. Usually, although universities have the data, they don't do anything about it. So if there is a terrible teacher, he continues to be a professor and nothing happens, and they still give him to teach time and again, which is a big, big mistake. So many universities have guidance programs to professor how to teach and so on and so forth, how to do it better. The good teachers take these classes, the bad teachers don't take them anyway, so it will remain in the same place. The quality teaching in universities is not something which is unique to universities. We also have it in high schools and so on. And I want to relate to high schools for 1 minute. We have a problem in high schools that while in primary schools, women, young girls, and boys perform more or less the same in mathematics and those realistic areas, when they come to secondary school, to high school, girls give up on mathematics. This is the society that I know. And they do it because of different social reasons. It has nothing to do with talents. Ladies are as talented as boys. In many cases, they do better. I have a solution for that, which I would like to try in Israel, and I will do it probably in the next couple of years. And the solution is the following. Number one, in order to have girls equally successful as boys, separate them in mathematical classes. I know it sounds terrible. Separate them. They will do much better, but they do not have to compete with the boys. They will achieve the same results as the boys. It has been tested by studies. It has been supported. This is number one. Number two, use technology. That means the following. select the best teacher of the subject in wherever the unit is, and let him or her produce clips of 45 minutes or so, teaching the subject according to the program, and have a teacher in the class while the students watch it, and the teacher can answer questions and create discussion. Number two. Number three, the clip should be shorter than that, maybe 20 minutes, all right? The rest will be discussion. Number three, make study groups, as you mentioned, three at a table, give them a problem to solve, and let them do it. This is called peer teaching. The best will teach the rest, and the final result will be by far better than anything we know today, in my opinion. I'm going to start a program like this in Israel in three schools, and if it is successful, the next year it will be spread.
Brilliant. Carl, you're on record commenting on MOOCs, and it'd be great for you to build on that and respond to some of the thoughts here.
I just look at the data, and the data, I mean, first Brian makes the point, MOOCs were supposed to be a wonderful cost-effective solution, and they're actually mostly more expensive in terms of, you look at the sort of number of student completions per dollar, they're quite a bit more expensive than having a real person there. So just from the economics, but now most of the MOOCs are putting the teachers, you know, doing lectures, and they're just being watched on a computer. Now, not all of them, there are exceptions which are more effective, but the great majority are, okay, the lecture's on a computer instead of standing up on a stage. I have to break the news to you, it's not really more effective, and we've got a lot of data showing that sitting there listening to lectures isn't very effective in any case. And so, you know, it's kind of like putting old bad wine into new bottles. It's still bad wine.
Yeah, there's a client of mine, an unnamed university president, who at the beginning of the MOOC revolution was fighting it and said, none of my teachers will ever get on. And then he was fighting to hold his professors back because they just saw it as a popularity contest, you know, who gets more clicks than the next guy.
So, I mean, I don't want to come across as anti-technology in this. I mean, part of my work is investigating. There are many ways that technology can really enhance the capabilities of a good instructor and improve learning, but you just have to make sure that the technology is being used in ways that we know enhance learning and good instructors, not just using it for technology's sake, which is often a failure.
Yeah, I just want to say that, you know, a MOOC doesn't make sure it's good. Actually, MOOCs are much harder to make good than even a lecture. But the nice thing is you get really good feedback straight through, and so you can actually learn. And when you've got 10,000 people from different cultures, you can kind of tease out things and say, this concept, we're really struggling with here. That's obviously they're not getting it, because they have to do these little quizzes afterwards, and you sort of measure the gain throughout it. So it is an interesting vehicle. I don't know where it's going. It's not a panacea by any means, but I do think it provides some people who have no education to higher education with something which is certainly better than they got, but it's not a substitute.
I think you meant no access to higher education. Yeah, you said no education.
I meant no access. Thank you.
Yeah.
No access to higher education.
Right. Yeah.
Tomas, you had a point?
Yeah, I'd like to make another comment, which is that what I observe from my students is that they learn the subject more deeply if they hear the topic from a Nobel laureate. So, like, they're much more motivated to hear something from a Nobel laureate than if a normal teacher would tell about it. If they say the same thing, but it's a Nobel laureate, then they're much more motivated. And that's something that you can do with a MOOC.
My experience is my class gets bored after the first day, just like I was a Nobel laureate.
Yeah, for myself, motivation was largely driven by fear in class. Yeah, I don't think a MOOC would have done it for me either, unless you could shock the student remotely. So let's move to the second theme, which is careers. Now, we have a lot of budding young scientists here. In the end, these people need to put a house and home over their head while doing earth-shattering and meaningful work. And I'm going to start again with Dan, because you know the Technion is legend in terms of helping students find their feet as entrepreneurs in science as a career. You know, the book Startup Nation was largely based on the experience of Technion, and you know, we'd all love to hear how that spark was created and how you keep it going.
Okay. This is a project that I started 30 years ago. 29 years ago, I started to teach a class at the Technion called Technological Entrepreneurship. The word startup did not exist. I used to call it technology business. Why did I do that? Because when I was a student at the Technion, the spirit of the Technion told us in many words, you will be so good that when you graduate, everybody will want to hire you. And I said, okay, that's really wonderful, but what if I want to open my own technology business? How do I do that? And the Technion did not teach that. 1986, I became a full professor, and I said, okay, now I can do whatever I want. And in 1987, I started this class, this is 29 years ago, to teach technological entrepreneurship. I invented it. I didn't hear about anything like this in the world. I don't know if it ever existed at that time. I bring to the class invited speakers, divided into three groups, successful entrepreneurs, struggling entrepreneurs, and professionals to talk about I bring a lawyer to talk about what is a limited company and why I should open one. I bring the patent officer of the country to talk about IP. I bring somebody to talk about marketing. I bring somebody to talk about market surveys and so on. I don't want to go into details, but this is a very successful class. In the first meeting, I had 800 students in my class, and the hall was only for 600 students. It was a smashing success, the largest class of the Technion ever. And it continues year after year for 29 years. So by now I have very many engineers and scientists in the country, more than 10,000, that took my class, and they have the chip of entrepreneurship embedded in their mind. I don't claim that I am the father of Startup Nation, but I contributed to that. There's no question about it. Can entrepreneurship be taught? Definitely yes. And if you go around the world and listen to what leaders say, they say innovation, innovation, innovation. And they say that because they do not understand that innovation has been there for generations in universities and research centers. Innovation is not the issue. How do you take the innovation and make it into a product? And that is called technological entrepreneurship. And this is why we should teach technological entrepreneurship in universities and even before that. I gave a talk in Aalto in Finland a year ago, and the subject was why we should teach technological entrepreneurship in every university in the world. And the meeting was for rectors of European universities. And in some countries, they got the message, and they start to do that now.
And before I move on to our other panelists, I do want to build on that and ask one other question, which is when people think of entrepreneurship, they think of success, but they're afraid of failure. How important is it to teach or help students or create an environment that accepts failure?
Okay, we don't lie to the students. We tell them that of 10 startups, 7 will fail, 2 will survive, 1 will do great. These are about the proportions. They know it. But we also deliver a message. And this message is especially important in the Far East, and also in Europe, in a way. And the message is, failure, okay, start again. And statistics show that in the next trial, you have a much better chance to succeed because you are an experienced entrepreneur. Yes, you failed, but you went through the stages. Next time, you have a much better time to succeed, and this is the message. And in some countries, I give many talks on this subject in many countries. In some countries, they want the title of my talk to be Failure okay, start again.
Brian, a question for you at ANU. You know, how do you think of programming the courses in the university to align with careers or opportunities for students? Do you work backwards from industry? Do you try to influence the way industry is headed? How do you think of that?
So I would say this is a journey we've just started on. We need to, you know, industry really, when you ask them in detail, especially Australian industry, they really think of training, not education. And there's a big difference between being a training institute and an education institute. The other thing you need to realize is that, you know, training is really getting the application at the very end. Depending on what you're being trained to do, you need to have different levels of education. And some things you need to be very sophisticated. My university is all about education. And trying to get that sense, that industry, that actually my job to get them to run your banking system or your whatever, that's not my job, that's your job. I do the public good side, you do the training bit at the end, or you have another provider to do it. And they need to, they want to get a shortcut. I mean, business is all about making money, and they like shortcuts. And I'm not going to be the shortcut for them. That's not my job. But on the other hand, I do need my faculty, my students to understand business. So part of it is teaching the skills that make sense so when they go out as an education point, that it is useful to understand how business and economics and stuff works, even if you are a physicist. But I also think you learn a lot by actually doing. And so I do think there's a lot to be said of providing, you know, internships and things. This is very big in Germany. It's not so big in the US or Australia. And so I think being able to provide people that chance to go in and just sort of see what they're learning and how it's used in action is a useful connection, because it'll help them when you're trying to work with industry as a physicist within universities, but also help them decide if that's what they want to do. So we have multi-layers there. The other thing I wanted to briefly talk about is we as universities have a monopoly right now on credentialing or providing degrees. That is actually not yet under threat, but it's going to be. And so I see the whole idea of people going out there and having all of their credentials in some public thing like a blockchain as being a real, real opportunity. And that's suddenly going to bring a bunch of non-university providers out there into the market. Now, the sophisticated business community is going to use that if it gives them better graduates. And already you can see Google and companies saying, actually, I don't really care about your degree. I want to actually use my own testing because I don't think you're doing a very good job. So it's really important for us to be adding value. And that's where we get back to Carl's technique, where we really do make smarter graduates. But then we also need to buy into that credentialing and giving more than you have a degree from ANU in physics. You're going to actually have a very sophisticated description of what you did at ANU, I think, in your degrees going forward, so that Google will say, ooh, I actually think that looks pretty good, and if I've added value, I've suddenly become the university of choice. So there's a lot going on there for us to interface, and again, rapidly changing. I'm playing around with lots of things because I don't want to get left behind.
And there's one point I want to pick up again before I move to Carl, which is you mentioned that it's important for your students and for your teachers to understand how industry will use what it is they're teaching.
Yes.
Is there an opportunity for the inverse? In other words, is there an opportunity for you to educate Goldman Sachs or KKR or some of the big investors and banks and even industry on how better to embed science in what they do?
Absolutely. And so, you know, when I have internships, not just students, it can be my postdocs and my professors who can go there. That's, you just got to have connections, and then you understand each other. So I'm not going to go up and lecture Goldman Sachs. That's exactly what Carl will tell you doesn't work. What I need to do is actually get my people there and practice and learn to think in each other's expert systems, and then people will make the connections. So it's a matter of embedding us ourselves, even if artificially initially, to make those connections. That's where I see the big gains are.
And Carl, you know, you and I had an email exchange a little earlier on some of these questions, and you had a fascinating response to a question that I wrongly asked about a shortage of scientists in the labor market, and your response was, well, actually, you know, is it quality, quantity? Is it about cost versus quality? And It'd be great for you to build on that in terms of, you know, is there a shortage of scientists out there? Why are companies looking for science at a lower cost when that could compromise quality and, you know, outcomes and all that matter?
Okay, so first, I want to make sure people understand I'm not making statements about the world. I'm making statements about the United States, okay, where the economies and things there. And I mean, there's lots of debate and has been for a number of years. Do we need more scientists and engineers, basically? And The economists argue back and forth on this, and I think it's just very hard to tell. The companies are always saying we need more, but if you look at the, but the economists come back and say, look, the effective salary of scientists and engineers is actually going down compared to other people who have to be spend that much time in education. So that says they're not valued, they're not needed. And you know, so there's a big debate of essentially whether the U.S. high-tech industry is importing cheap foreign labor, essentially. I mean, we do bring in lots of foreign scientists and engineers, and it's been a wonderful success.
Even a foreign historian once in a while,
yeah.
Believe it or not.
Well, yeah, but they but the visas mostly go to scientists. Yeah. It's a lot easier to get a visa than a green card. Yeah. And so that's just a, you know, an ongoing debate, and I don't think there's any real clear answer there. What is pretty clear, actually, and it's sort of an interesting different way to think about this, is that when people have looked at the needs for, let's say, technical literacy, knowing some science, knowing some things about science and engineering, in fields that are not considered science and engineering fields, those needs have been going up very clearly and very substantially. And so, you know, the person who's going into banking or sort of things you wouldn't think of as technical, they get paid more if they have more, you know, science and engineering math backgrounds. And yes. So, you know, that's something everybody, all the economists can agree, is there's real value there. And it's really and those aspects of the, the workforce that you need, those are very clearly growing a lot. And so I think that's just a different way of thinking about it. It's not so clear we need more scientists and engineers, but we need a lot more people who aren't labeled as science and engineers, but having many of these basic skills and knowledge.
Absolutely. I borrowed the laptop off a friend of mine who's an investor in a purely financial institution, and when I clicked into the browser and saw the bookmarks, they were all hyper-technical, scientific, and I was like, you know, you could have benefited from studying science instead of finance.
Yeah. But,
Tomas, turning to you, you know, there's been so much, at least public excitement in the last decade around the success of technology companies like a Google or an Airbnb. There have been phenomenal discoveries in science like, you know, gravity waves. You know, these things have made the front page of the news. Do you think it has influenced more researchers or even just more students in aggregate to get excited about careers in science?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think these discoveries are making people to go into science. So, it could be like the end of something, but then you discovered it, but it's also the beginning of the precision of that thing. So like in the case of the Higgs discovery, we discovered the Higgs boson, but we need to study the properties of the Higgs boson. So we need new students who go to and do the PhD in the properties of the Higgs boson. Again, with the gravitational waves, we need to study the gravitational waves more in detail. So I think it's a very, very good motivation for the young scientists to go into these topics.
And what do you do to encourage your students to stick on with science as a career?
Well, yeah. So, with the high school students, I also give them like this the front of the science, like gravitational waves. Or actually, there was a student who I gave the article about the gravitational wave discovery, and they understood some part of it. But anyway, they were motivated by it.
And just coming, switching now to the subject, again, just because we have to watch our time, gender. And how is it that we can, you know, Danny was just talking about how boys and girls, up to the end of primary school, in math and science, they're neck to neck. And I've seen studies that say actually girls will sometimes outperform the boys, especially in math, at the end of primary school. But we see this tremendous and horrific drop-off afterwards. And again, just to sort of go through the age cohorts, it'd be great, you know, you'd mentioned, Dan, you've already mentioned some experiments or some ideas you'd like to implement. You know, Carl, do you want to build on that and think about, you know, it'd be great if you could share the theory, but it'd be great if perhaps if you have one, share perhaps a personal experience of how you've been able to influence a female scientist to stick on for a PhD, to stick on and pursue a career in science.
Okay. So it's a lot easier to talk about the, you know, my research on this area of what matters and what doesn't.
Given that you're a socialist, the theory would be easier, yes.
So the realities are that these are shaped by, I mean, we sort of worry about what we try and do in departments and you know, with individual courses, but in reality, these are really primarily shaped by societal influences, societal perceptions. And from my own work, we find that the most useful is to look at the social psychologists who look at how social values shape a person's reaction. And so we were coming over in the boat here, surrounded by young women physicists, and they were talking about, you know, the issues they had faced, and it's, you know, talking about, and it's very clear that, okay, they're facing all, you know, it's a hard thing to do to get a PhD and be successful, and everybody has to work really hard in that, and when you're also faced by, you know, keep bumping into these little societal messages of, you know, you really shouldn't be doing this. You should be off, you know, being a housewife or a teacher, or, you know, shouldn't go into physics. And so so these are the things that really matter. And it's how one can counter those kind of messages. And, you know, so partly the message is, and you talk about the sort of personal things, but it's also you need to send the same message in all our courses and really at a broader university level of, you know, look, that's, you know, we recognize there's these broad influences out there, but you have to realize that these are not really saying anything about you as a person, you individually as your abilities, that everybody has these concerns, but that everybody faces up to them and gets through it and can be successful. And so it's really that message of you have to think of yourself as how, what you want to do, what you can be successful, and sort of not let this background noise of against you that's, you know, clearly changing, but it changes slowly to make too big an impression.
I'd like to add a couple of comments on this. There are two important bodies that can affect a child to become a scientist, and the most important one is the parents. If the parents convey a message to their child, boy or girl, that they expect him or her to go through the process of learning and go to a university in a specific area that they choose, then it has a great effect. A child should know what his parents are expecting of him or her. I can tell you that in my family, my children, my grandchildren, my message was always, you start in the kindergarten, you finish your studies when you finish your PhD, and there is nothing to talk about in between. And it worked.
No fireside chat, nothing over dinner, just...
Number two, a very influential entity is television. Now, you know why television is called medium? Because it is neither rare nor is it well done. Now, if we have more science, real science program on television, and some channels in Britain, in other countries, do it very well. But in the rest of the world, if you open the television arbitrarily, in 5 minutes, you think this is very stupid. Whatever they do is stupid. We need more guidance and more collaboration with television channels around the world so that they will spread the gospel of science and technology and good education, and also humanities, arts, and so on. They have an important role. If we could convince them to do that, we will achieve a lot.
And Brian, what do you do at ANU to encourage female role models, senior role models as researchers, to create an environment that says women can succeed. So again, let's assume that there are no personal biases against women in the university. Even so, what do you do to make sure the environment, which may today as a legacy be predominantly male, what do you do to say, well, that's not our future?
Well, in the end, you need to just look at the data and see, you know, where things are going. We have almost 60% of our biology undergraduates are female now, so it's actually female bias because women perform much better at undergraduate in Australia, noticeably better than their males. So we have a good pipeline there. Computer science, less than 10%. If you look at a successful computer scientists in our department, they all have coded since they're young. The fraction of young women who, or you know, girls who code, very small. It's just culture. We have a real problem. Engineering is another pipeline problem. So just having role models is not enough. So the head of my engineering is a woman. There's one other female professor in that department. Those are my only women in that department. So I can start building up. But the reality is I've only got, you know, 7 to 10% of the undergraduates coming through there. Within the university itself, you need to look and say, well, where are the pinch points? So if I look at how my students do in physics, roughly 25% of our incoming students are women. They progress about equally with men through the undergraduate. They matriculate to PhDs at a very similar rate. I don't lose that many women. And they go into the first level of postdoc at about the same level as well. So I'm doing pretty well up to people in the pre-30 years. And that's actually not just me. The U.S. is very similar. Then I have this terrible place where people get permanent jobs. There's a huge pinch point there. And the probability of advancing is probably about half for women. So I clearly have a problem there. I'm not going to go into why I think that is, but it's a problem. And so it comes down to and saying, when you really look at it, I think it's fundamentally is that the career structure is unattractive. And I can work on the little bits and pieces and make my environment good, which is the question you asked me, but the reality, that's not my problem. So the first thing is to realize that is, the data is saying that's not my main problem. It's secondary, it's important for me to work at, and yes, I want to do that, but it's realizing where the problem is. And I have ultimately a career structure that is unattractive to lots of people. So one of my best students that I had, this is an anecdote, but it illustrates the problem. She finished, and she came up to me and she apologized. Said, Brian, you're going to hate me. And I said, why? What's going on? She said, I don't want to stay in academia. I'm going to go work for the startup. Much better career structure. And I said, fine by me. I think that's a success. But it's a failure for academia because I've just had one of my best students say, this looks awful to me. I don't want to go through this. And that happens all the time. And women are preferentially leading the feeding. And a lot of men are leaving it as well. So that's the problem I need to solve. And I'm afraid I can improve my child care. I can get rid of bullying. I can have mentors and all those stuff. They're all secondary. And yes, I'm going to do them all. But I got to fix my big problem, which is giving my young staff a reasonable career structure, which does not select the people who can stand a bad career structure, which are preferentially men.
Got it. And I have the hardest question for you, Tomas. So it says here very impressively that you're on the supervisory board of the Hungarian Association of Physics Students. How many people on the board, how many are women, and what are you going to do to raise the proportion once you go home?
Okay, so... I was actually also the president. I was also the president for this association for 2 years. So now after the presidency, I became the supervisory board. So actually so now in the board there are like two. So the board consists of five people, from which two are women.
Oh, okay.
So that's a good ratio.
There you go, you survived that one.
Yeah.
Now, we're going to move to the next subject on emerging markets just so we can turn over and provide some time for the students to ask questions. But this is an all-male panel, and I do hope that a lot of the questions we get are from women, and I hope that some of those questions are challenging some of the statements made up here by the guys on this stage. So I do hope to see some of that. So our last section is going to be, our subject is going to be on emerging markets. And I guess my first question on emerging markets, and I'll leave it open to the panelists who wants to pick it up, which is, in emerging markets, when we look at the discrepancy of research coming out, the number of scientists, is it just the money, or is it something else? In other words, if we pumped more money into the tertiary systems in, pick a country, China, South Africa, Nigeria, would that fix the problem, or do we have a deeper-rooted issue, which may be cultural, related to creativity, related to expectations?
Well, I mean, from my perspective, you can look at China as a great example. Exponential growth within research and development. There's a hysteresis, right? It takes 25 years. You just can't say, here's a bunch of professors. You have to train them, and they take time, and they learn. It's an expert system. It takes tens of thousands of hours of work to become great. So in emerging markets, initially have pioneers who typically get out and trained in the other places. So for example, ANU, my university, was founded in 1946 to become the first research university of Australia. And we are the first place to offer PhDs. And our job was to create the pioneers who went out and populated the rest of Australia. And we did that. And actually not just us, Indonesia and the areas around us. So the problem my university faces is we've done that. And now we have a bunch of competition, and our university hasn't quite figured out what its reason to exist is next. So I actually think it's just a matter of countries getting to the point where they're prepared to have a long enough vision to say, we need to invest in our human capital. And you have to have stability of governance, of government, you have to have governance, you need to have fiscal places to do that. You got to have a 20-year horizon. It's got to be a 20-year building process in an emerging market to do that. China is doing that, and China is going to be a major player from here on out. They haven't caught up, but the amount they're spending right now, they will. And it's just a matter of time. And, you know, that's what emerging markets have to do, but it comes down to the fundamentals of the country and the stability of those countries that I think you need to really get things to take off.
Dan, Carl, do you have any thoughts on that? How do we get Africa and the rest of Asia and Latin America up the curve?
I'll just agree with what Brian said. I mean, I think he summarized everything I know about it. So.
Okay. Since you mentioned Africa, I want to mention something about Africa. There's a lot of Chinese money flowing now to Africa because they buy all the natural resources in Africa. And Africa now has a chance, maybe the single chance, to really develop and develop fast, if they invest well in education and in science, if they can form good government policies toward education and science, if they can beat corruption, then they have a wonderful chance now to really exponentially grow in science and education. It's a once-in-a-lifetime chance, maybe, for Africa to really do it, to really do it well, and the time is now.
Now, I would like to ask the panelists to each give a sort of a one-minute closing statement before we turn over to questions from the audience. And so, and this could be a summarization of some of a message you've already shared, but if you had to say, look, this is the one thing that I would say, or I would want to improve to give to the world of education and the scientists, you know, to science, what would it be? Carl, let's start with you.
Well, just to repeat the same old message I keep giving, as we've seen now there are much better ways, much more effective ways to do in higher education. They don't cost any more money, you know, and it's just a question of adopting them. And unlike all of these other issues we've talked about, which are hard, complicated, we don't quite know what to do, this is one place that it's just straightforward. You just do it and it works. So,
do it and it works. Danny.
No, I didn't understand the question. Can you repeat it for me?
So just a closing statement, a one-minute closing statement, that if you had to say one thing to the audience about what the most important thing is to do now in education and the sciences, what is it? It could be a repeat of something you said, but just 30 seconds, 1 minute, and then we move on to Q&A.
Okay. Number one, select the teachers in a better way than it is done now. Number two, compensate them properly, so that in each and every country, the profession of teaching will have a good prestige, and that young people, talented young people, will be able to provide for the families with one salary of a teacher. This is rare, but this is what we should do. This is number one. Number two, governments should pay attention to the development of human ingenuity, and they should bring partners like television channels to the game to promote it. These are the two things that I think are most important now.
Brian.
All right, obviously what Carl and Danny said, but also to realize that in the end you need, if you're gonna do what we're saying over here, you need leadership. And as I said in my leadership session, everyone is a leader. So you need to go through and make the change start happening. Demand that it happens. Ask questions. Ask why is it that we're not doing what the data says. That's how you show leadership. And people here have been selected to be leaders, so be leaders.
Tomas.
Yeah, well, I would say that this mentoring system should be more widened in the world. And so learn home a lot and go to the mentor and ask them.
Now, before we do Q&A, very short thing. I want you to turn to the person next to you, and I want you to quickly chat about something you've learned and the question you want to ask the most. Just it helps you get to know your neighbor. Let's do that for 60 seconds, and then we're going to turn to Q&A. So just turn to the person next to you, say, hey, what's the best thing I learned? And this is the question I want to ask.
Very cool.
Nearly done. Good job, guys. I think everyone's awake. That's the gold standard. Okay. Let's give them 10 seconds more. Okay, are we ready to go with questions? I take it from all the chatter that there's a lot that we've learned, and there are a lot of questions that are going to get asked. We have, because we're in Germany, we're going to keep this on time. So we have 28 minutes on the clock for questions. I will request people who are asking questions to actually ask questions as opposed to making statements. But with that, go for it. So please, there are a couple of mics. And I think you've got to come up to the mic to ask a question. The mic doesn't go to you. We haven't figured the physics for that yet.
It might be people have trouble seeing the mics.
Yeah, so the mics are just in the aisles. There's one up front here, and there's one back there. Please.
Yep. Hello, yeah. My name is Aftab Hussain. I am from King Abdullah University of Science and Technology, KAUST for short, in Saudi Arabia. So I have a question to Dan, but before that, a quick comment to Karan. When you borrow your friend's laptop, you don't look at the browser history. That's a scientific fact. Okay. Sir, I wanted to ask you, like, so I'm a father of a three-year-old child. So like any other child, he basically plays with everything like football and Lego and cars and whatever else, and mobile phones these days. So, and I think for a 3 or 4 year old child, it's I think for me, it's very hard to determine what he really likes to do. Like, would his aptitude be more in science or arts or history or athletics or whatever else? So for instance, if I send him to something like a science kindergarten, would I be stifling his career, potential career as a world leading athlete, for instance?
Can somebody repeat the question? I'm too sensitive to your accent. Can you repeat it for me?
He's wondering.
What is the question?
Yeah. So the question is, if you send a kid to a science school, maybe they'd be happier or better going into literature or music or art and so.
Or becoming a sportsman.
Or okay. Yeah. Are you
absolutely
inhibiting them?
The soft teaching of arts. And poetry and novel writing and music and so on gives taste to our lives. But engineering and science gives us life. And we are here, engineers and scientists, so this is why we discuss it here. In another conference that you may attend, they will talk about literature and music and jewelry making and so on, and it is fine too.
Dan is obviously not biased at all by his career, you know, so he's speaking objectively. Brian?
So here in Germany, they have a program called Little Scientists, which is making sure that kindergartners do get a science degree. I personally believe it should be universal, that every kindergarten should have a good science, but it should also have good English and good arts, because that's part of being human. And so my view is you should have universality, and it comes down to having good teachers, good systems, where we make sure everyone gets a good science degree, not just those that whose parents think they should.
Yeah. Carl, did you have something to add to that?
The reality is, you're right. I mean, you know, those kind of decisions, like any other decisions you make as a parent, constrain or open up different sets of opportunities for your child and cut off others. And that's just a choice you get that's what makes it hard being a parent, right?
Let's go to the cool guy wearing sunglasses in the back.
Hello, my name is Michael Finch. I'm from the U.S. So Albert Einstein's name has been dropped quite a few times during the meeting this week. So does anybody know that he's they believe him to have a learning disability. So on the lines of the gender research that you all seem to know a lot about, is there any research pertaining to folks with learning disabilities or disabilities in general? I know a little bit of the statistics of the U.S. So generally in the U.S., around 10 to 20% of the population has a disability. However, only less than 2% of those folks actually graduate with a PhD. So I think there's also a big gap in that. And in general, from the language I've heard in the past, they categorize women, learning disability folk, or disability in general, and even racial minorities in the U.S. as underrepresented minority groups. So I was just curious on what your all's thoughts on that. Thank you.
Can I jump in?
Go over it.
So, you know, this, you raise what is an important issue. You're right, they're underrepresented. They do face special challenges. And that's a place where we're still learning. We don't have the answers. There are in particular types of disabilities. People are finding much more effective ways to teach the students and essentially, you know, make those disabilities so they're not disabilities. But this is far from universal, and it continues to be an active and much needed area of research that we don't have many answers on yet.
Ron, you have an ANU perspective
to
add to that?
If I can be honest, universities are appallingly bad at dealing with disability of all sorts. Probably our worst, if I had to say the place where we perform the worst, that's it. Again, we don't even really know how to do it very well, so it's a learning activity. And I'm sensitive to it, but I'll be honest, it's one thing that I don't quite yet know how to deal with, if I'm honest.
So a really thoughtful and great question, and it's something for our panelists to take home to their universities and their research. Let's move to the front, Mike.
Hi, I wanted to ask, I'm Julieta Grusco from the U.S., wanted to ask if you could speak a bit to graduate teaching, and particularly graduate teaching for experimentalists. It seems to me that theoretical physics has kind of pinned down what skills they're interested in teaching students and evaluating in graduate students, the idea of solving multi-part problems, things like that. It's less clear to me that experimental physicists know how to teach the skills that are important in being a good physicist, or that we know how to evaluate them, or that we even know how to describe what they are. So if any of you have kind of done any thinking on that, I was curious if you could speak to it.
So what makes a good physicist other than a sense of humor?
I don't know. I have a scar from the Millikan oil drop experiment right here. I never forgot to remind myself that your lab partner needs to know not to plug in the high voltage between the plates when you're holding it. So I learned a very valuable lesson and nearly died because of it. I'm not sure that I completely agree with you. I think there's a huge number of skills. Of course, if I'm, you know, when you look at your education you get at the PhD level, theorists seem to dominate it. You do a lot of classes that are theory-based, and then you do a couple afterthought things, a Bayesian analysis or something, usually taught to you by a theorist as well. But again, on-the-job training, you go out and, you know, and if you're an astronomer, we send you out to a telescope, usually with supervision the first couple times and then on your own, and you sort of learn that way. So it's when you get into the PhD, it really is this expert learning mode. And I defer to Carl whether or not we understand, you know, it's quite hands-on right now, and you sort of get in and do it. That seems to be a pretty effective way of learning. It's very expensive, but is there any way of doing better? I don't know.
Yeah, I should clarify.
The mic, please, just so that everyone can, yeah.
I should clarify. I'm mostly curious about things like qualifying exams and kind of the early graduate career of how do you decide that someone has the correct skills to move forward in a PhD when we don't know how to test those skills without putting someone in a lab, I guess.
Yeah, okay. So you're right. Right now, that's almost entirely based on being in a lab. You can go do a search and turn up a few papers that I've written recently, actually, on the cognitive skills of experimental science. There's some research groups, including my own, actually thinking of how we can assess those skills in a more meaningful way. Right now, it's entirely based on the kind of apprenticeship model, being in the lab, interacting with the instructor, and yeah, it's only after you get into that and find out, oh, this wasn't for me. And so that's a little bit of a problem. And the real answer to that, which a lot of universities, you know, and you're from the US, it's really becoming more and more common and almost dominant, is that students get as undergraduates the real opportunity to work on real research problems within labs, and so that they can, even in that environment, get some sense of their own, I would say what matters most, their own sense of satisfaction, threshold of frustration, et cetera, but then also some evaluation of maybe that's not the right direction for them to be going. And that's really the best we have now, but it's a fairly effective system.
So we should refer to Carl's paper. I wish I had. The story of my career has largely been it wasn't for me.
But yeah.
Let's go to the back, Mike.
Hi, my name is Zara. I'm from Georgia, now Germany. My question concerns outreach, and specifically the rising niche of YouTube videos. I wonder if any of you collaborated with one of the YouTubers, and what do you think general about this format of short videos, 3 up to 10 minutes? And if you think that like one is like really nice and it can give a possibility to people who maybe don't have inspiring teachers at school to actually like get inspired and like very, very interested in science, or you think that maybe these 3 to 10 minutes videos give a false hope that people like become an expert after 10 minutes and then they don't actually learn anything? So what is your stand on that? I mean,
Danny, you've dabbled in YouTube.
Can you repeat the question?
So the question is that there are these YouTube videos being posted now.
Yes.
They're very short, 3, 5, 8, 10 minutes. Yeah. And I believe, let me see if I've got the question right. And you know, the question is that are these videos useful or are they giving people the false impression of knowledge and expertise?
Okay, I have 2 comments on that. Number one, everything that directs the public towards science, and even as a hint, which is a short time, is blessed. It's very good. Number two, extension that there are many MOOCs now, which are classes that are given by the best university and the best professors. And these are wonderful programs that everybody can take, and it's for free unless you want to get some certificate, then you have to pay for it. The problem with the MOOCs is that people start with a lot of enthusiasm and they quit. They quit after a while. The solution to that, by the way, is quite interesting. If you form groups of studies by the MOOCs, then everybody continues and they don't quit in the middle of the way. So learning individually by your own from the internet doesn't continue as it should. And if you form a group, you make a little class, then you are related to your friends in the class, and you can explain to each other and foster the understanding of each other, and then it works very, very well. So, yes, internet, different kinds of classes, but also socialize, make a group to do it together.
With the permission of the panel, just because there's so many students who want to ask questions, we could move forward. Unless, Brian, unless you're burning to add something to that.
Well, I was just going to say that useful but not sufficient. That is, it doesn't replace education. It's a useful thing. We should support it, but it's not the same as a full learning activity.
Let's go to the front, Mike.
It's a bit of a height disadvantage here. Hello, I'm Mary, originally from Israel and now in the UK. So a slightly more general question. So critical thinking and reasoning skills are useful not just in science and education. They make the key ingredient for a successful democratic society. Do you have any ideas how to teach high quality reasoning skills to the general populations?
Who wants to take that?
Yeah.
I just written a paper on it, like many other things. We have just written a paper on Proceedings National Academy. Very quickly, though, the first thing you have to recognize is, I mean, when we talk about, you know, critical reasoning skills, people don't actually have critical reasoning skills. They have critical reasoning skills within narrow segments, and they are not very good at actually transferring those over, which frankly is what we need for sort of broad society. You need to be looking at claims politicians are making and applying the same sort of tests of evidence. So that really involves them having to get sort of critically thinking across a variety of areas, and many of these areas aren't going to be scientific, as it's just a reality. But in the work that I'm just talking about, we just published, we did show that you really can have people learn this, where I talk about critical thinking specifically in science, of evaluating data and evaluating the claims and models based on that data when there's some degree of uncertainty. And the bottom line is that we have a bunch of data showing that traditional instructional labs are really bad at teaching this. The key element that we've put in that seems to be important to work is, first, there has to be a decision-making process. You have to put the learner in, you know, that's ultimately what matters in critical thinking, is how you make a decision about things. And so you put them in a position of having to make a decision, but also having a chance to iterate multiple times on making a decision, reconsider trying something else, and then having to think about whether the decision was right, etc.
Great, let's go to the back, Mike.
So my name is Sebastian Zell and I'm from Germany. My question is in particular to Brian, I'm very glad that you mentioned the bad career structure in science, and I'd be interested in what would be your potentially idealized vision of improving that.
Well, the first thing is being honest with graduates that, you know, if you look at Danny, when he finished his PhD, he knew he had about a 2/3 chance of staying in academia. When I finished, it was about 30%, and you guys are all 5%. That's the ratio of PhDs we're creating versus the positions available. So you need to know that. You should not be sold this idea that you're a failure if you don't go into academia, because 95% of you are not going to go into academia. And I'm sorry to tell you that, if that's a surprise. It's the reality. Do the numbers.
This is a fairly select group, Brian. I expect it's a liar than 5%.
Your probability is higher than 5%. But it ain't 2/3. All right. So from my perspective, given that, I need to create a career structure where I give people multiple paths out. That's the internships, being able to bounce in and out of university. But it's also within my academic career structures, making decisions early on for people, and essentially having, since we have McKinsey here, it's an up and out strategy. McKinsey, if you go work for McKinsey, you'll understand that, which is you either succeed or we move you on, rather than hanging people on indefinitely and essentially preying on their desperation and then ultimately cutting them off well past their when they should be. And that's also bad because, you know, every person in university costs resources and things, and you end up as a university spreading your resources too thinly and then, you know, sort of abandoning people when they're 40, when they could have gone off and developing their skills to do something else. So from my perspective, it's banking very clear signals and saying, you know, we have a 5-year period where it's post-bac, just go off and do it, and then making a decision saying, these are the people I'm going to keep in my university and I'm going to give them enough resources to do great things. And not saying, I'm going to have a bob, as we would say, each way on 7 people, and then whoever is left after 20 years of soft money is who I'm going to keep, because that selects a certain type of person and probably not what I want, and I under-resource everyone.
I wouldn't be too discouraged by Brian's comment, because the 95% that wouldn't go into academia will pick up stock options in a startup, be very successful one day, and then give back to Linda Nobel. That's how it works.
Or to the A&U. Front mic.
Hi, a very good afternoon. I'm Ryan from India. So recently I noted that a lot of educationists, perhaps most notably Eric Mazur, have been toying with the idea of the inverted classroom, where the student studies the material initially at his room or something and then goes and solves problems in the class. So I was wondering if this is an effective strategy that leads to better learning, or can this ever be a replacement for the more conventional classroom methods that we have today?
So can the student learn in their own room, being question one?
Can I go first, and then maybe you follow? So Eric invited me, and I was one of the people who assessed his learning outcomes in this at Harvard last year. It was really quite interesting. And they had quite a general class go out and do quite a sophisticated learning exercise of creating an imaging spectrograph with groups of 6 or 7. And I was impressed what these people had to do, but I was also impressed by the incredible amount of effort that Harvard put into supporting this activity. And, you know, I was told, oh, it's not that many people. And I think I counted 22 people helping with the process for 90-person class. Wow. Now, that's great, but even Harvard can't do that for every class. So it's an incredibly effective way, I think, at doing specific things, but I don't think you're going to be able to do it in every class every time. So I was very impressed with what I saw, but I don't think you can do everything there. And I think it's good for certain types of learning, but it's not clear to me you can do everything that way either.
Should we move to the next question?
I think there's a misunderstanding here, actually. I think what you're talking about is this kind of the technique of peer instruction and so on that Eric was doing a number of years ago. Brian's actually talking about what Eric is doing now, which is a rather different approach. I think this general idea of active learning, that students aren't just getting simple information transfer, they're really thinking and getting feedback in the classroom, that's clearly better. And that was what my talk was about. You can go look at my slides and it sort of goes through the details and references on that.
The theme of Carl's speech is just go read my research. You don't even
need
to meet me.
But I just talked about that. But the basic concept is good, but it's a little different than what Brian is actually thinking about. Eric has gone off on this really massive labor-intensive.
Just to clarify, my question was about Eric using the classroom primarily for solving problems rather than delivering content.
So that's what he did in this case.
No. But there is a whole bunch of other stuff.
Let's take a few more questions. Yeah. Back mic.
Hello, my name is Winifred from Ghana. So this question is directed to Danny specifically, because you really got me thinking about in a society of high rates of corruption and in my stand of not really having much influence, so how do I, as a young woman, contribute in my own special way to the development of my country? And also, you got me thinking about now in my stage, I have a younger ones coming up, so how do I help to change the way things are seen in my side of origin? So, and that's my question.
How can she, in a very corrupt country where they're very few systems to support her? How can she affect change and inspire others?
Okay. Well, everybody can contribute to changes. I know it is very difficult in some countries, but if you become a teacher, you may be a professor, university teacher, and you affect your close environment, this will be your contribution. Otherwise, go to politics and make an effect there and try to overcome corruption.
This is good advice, going to politics? Okay, young man in the front, you are the last question of the day, so make it count because you're what stands between everybody here and lunch.
So, hello, I'm Julian from Munich. And so the picture of most of my friends who are not in physics or math is basically that physics and math is you take the right equation and you solve it. Okay, and I think the reason for this is because that in high school this is how we mostly are introduced into these subjects. So there are equations and we have to use them, but teachers don't explain where they're coming from, what are the reasons for these. And I think that's what puts most of the people away from math and physics very, very, very early and very quickly in high school already. So, but the challenge that I see is that for teachers to tackle this, to really, I mean, you cannot do a university education in high school, right? But you can at least give a hint that there are underlying reasons for this. But to give the right hints, I think you need exceptional insight, right? So my question is, do you think this is even possible to get teachers like this? I mean, they won't be all like little Richard Feynman's, right? So I think it's very difficult to do this. It's one of the most difficult things.
It looks like everyone wants to take it. Okay, Carl, go read your paper.
Read my paper. Sorry. This is actually something my research group has done quite a bit of study on, and it's a growing field, a growing aspect of physics education research is sort of the students' attitudes about physics and how you go about learning physics. And I will say it doesn't take tremendous insight. It just takes a clear understanding of what's shaping these views and properly addressing them. And two very quick and simple things are that the instructor has to put some meat, instead of dealing with introducing it all as formalisms and these artificial, massless, frictionless systems, they've got to put it in a real context, and the formalism comes in to solve real problems that some of them might care about. But then the other aspect that we've seen turns out to be very important is being much more explicit about the process of science, particular physics, and how it's a process of developing models based on evidence and then using those models and continue to test, and as they fail, as you find in situations where they fail, how we have to introduce new models. That actually has a big impact on those very specific student attitudes that you talked about. And then there's other things about testing and grading that come in that can also be important.
I know you want to answer, but there's a young lady who stuck it out by the mic despite my saying it's last question. So should we accommodate her?
The wrong incentives, but...
Thank you. Carolyn Parchetta, JPL from the USA. My question's for all of you, but mostly for Carl. You, at least in what I've heard you say...
You know what he's going to say, it's just read his paper.
I know, but I'd like to hear it from him directly. I have yet to hear you acknowledge that there are different learning styles, and so I'm curious if your research shows this dramatic increase in those who learn best by doing and teaching, but actually a decrease in comprehension by those who learn best through writing.
Okay, I have not read papers or done research on this. There has been a lot of research done on learning styles, and basically the research says the idea of learning styles is an erroneous myth, widely held but quite incorrect, that there is no style by which makes a particular person learn better or more effectively. There's very often personal preferences, but when people test them, it's just not, it doesn't work.
Okay. Can you list a reference for that?
Yes.
Now, look, the time has come to close this panel. I can see there's still life in us. It's time for the picnic. But before we head out for the picnic, I would like to thank the Bernadotte family for hosting us in this magnificent place. I would like to thank the Lindau Nobel Foundation for creating this unique forum. And I would like to thank the esteemed panelists who have shared their wisdom and humor and knowledge with us today. Thank you all. Thank you.